Well, as we continue in worship this morning, would you turn in your Bibles, please, to 2 Corinthians chapter 12. And Lord willing, we will finish the last three verses of this chapter, leaving us only one chapter left. I feel like every time we complete a chapter, I need to just say, you guys are incredible. You stuck with it. You're still going. It's good. Well, in this, we see Paul is going to explain to the Corinthian church, at least in letter form here, that his defense is not about this one-on-one, them and him, as he's been conversing through the letter and calling out the false teachers, as he's been challenging us as followers of Jesus in our integrity and our conviction. He's going to explain to them that his purpose is the upbuilding, and it's in the presence of Christ. Paul has that, you know, that triangle looking, I don't know what that's called. He looks to the Lord and then down on the situation, and he believes, and of course we as followers, of course, God is omnipresent. He begins to unfold this drive, this passion is because of Christ, because of edification is the word I used, and I'll use in the sermon and through this passage, to build up the church is what the word means. We'd be spiritually growing. And so I titled this message, Edification in the Church. We'll see in this passage why it is vital. He uses the word, the last word in my translation, verse 21, the word practiced. There are those in the congregation who are practicing sins. Paul has some things to say about that, but I think it's important that we grab that same word and we realize that in our own walk, we need to be marked as those who are following after Jesus. We are working out our salvation. We are practicing and implementing God's word. Now, I know some of you this morning are going, oh, no, he's just going out our holiness. I'm struggling. Maybe some of you are in that boat. I love this quote from John Newton. I think this probably resonates with every single one of us. But John Newton said these words, I am not what I might be. I am not what I ought to be. I am not what I wish to be. I am not what I hope to be. But I thank God I am not what I once was. And I can say with the great apostle, by the grace of God, I am what I am. I believe John Newton, along with all our brothers and sisters throughout history, would speak to the idea of it. It's not perfection in this life that happens in glory, but it is a direction of our lives. We see, and the closer we walk with the Lord, the more we're aware of just our struggle with sin, the awareness of sin. Paul, at the end of his life, one of his last letters, would speak of his own self as being the chief of sinners. We feel it. But I want to encourage you this morning that even though you're struggling with sin, you're on the right side. It is those who are not struggling that do need some, should concern you. I guess we could say it like that. But Paul, writing to this church, reveals to this church the importance, his desire, his whole writing of the letter, his whole point in suffering for the churches. He speaks to the upbuilding. He'll reference that in chapter 13, verse 10, that his authority, which the Lord gave him, is for building up and not tearing down. This is Paul's conviction that we as a church would be ever growing and ever developing, and ever pursuing right after Christ. You're not going to be perfect. So if you think you are, let me bring you into a reality check there. Nobody is. That happens in glory, but we continue to work, we continue to walk, we continue to seek after the Lord. And this is what Paul is expecting of the church. But of course, as we read the passage, you will see that he has definitely some hesitation regarding that. So this is what he says. This is the last three verses, 19, 20, and 21 of 2 Corinthians chapter 12. And he says, all this time you have been thinking that we are defending ourselves to you. Actually, it is in the sight of God that we have been speaking in Christ, and all for your upbuilding, beloved. Here's his reason. Right? He writes, this is for your upbuilding. For, I am afraid that perhaps when I come, I may find you to be not what I wish, and you and may be found by you to be not what you wish. There's going to be a confrontation. That perhaps there will be strife, jealousy, angry tempers, disputes, slanders, gossip, arrogance, disturbances. I'm afraid that when I come again, my God may humiliate me before you, and I may mourn over many of those who have sinned in the past and not repented of the impurity, immorality, sensuality that they have practiced. Let me offer a brief prayer as we look at this passage. Father, now as we turn to your word, we ask that you would open it to us, that your spirit would be informing us, instructing us, and teaching us this morning. I pray that I would be out of the way, that each soul would receive, Lord, what we need. Let us have ears to hear. And Father, guide us and grow us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, as I mentioned earlier, Paul has been defending himself. He has been writing and speaking to the false teachers. But through this whole conversation in chapter 12, we'll say it a conversation, it's a letter form, he has spoken to our conviction. We are to be those marked by humility. We are those who are in line as followers of Jesus, who are aligned with God's purposes. It is our desire to seek the benefit of others. We're not just simply here to be redeemed, although that's part of it. We are here to let others know about our redemption. We saw that through verses 11 through 13. He spoke to our sacrificial service. That's always something to talk about, service and sacrificial service. But he said it is. We're to be focused. There's a character to it. We are not to be those humbly, grumbly Christians. I don't know, I could ask this question and imagine all of you would respond, pretty rhetorical. Do you enjoy being around humbly, grumbly people? No, I would imagine. I don't, if you do, you're an odd one, okay? We don't like to be around those. And if we have the joy of the Lord, well, Paul says there is a character about us following. There's a character about us serving. There's a character about us as we go about our day. There's a character that exudes from us. And yes, sometimes we might go through difficulties, but even in that context, there is a hope that transcends the world. It is Christ, and so we're committed to this. And Paul even goes to the lengths of saying we're committed to this, even if those in whom we love show no recompense. Even if those we are serving and loving don't respond in the way we think should be right and just, it doesn't change us from cheerfulness to humbly grumblies. We continue on because our eyes aren't fixed upon the situation, they're fixed upon Christ. And so Paul then walks us through the importance of integrity, how those we run with define our character, and how we are to be marked as those who are willing to love one another enough to speak the truth. And so Paul, rounding out this chapter, of course, there's no chapter, he's just writing his letter. He comes to the importance of the church, his purpose in serving, his purpose in all of these things is what? That you would be built up, that you would be growing in your sanctification, that you would be growing in your edification. We can ask the question at the beginning of these verses, what can happen to a church that doesn't pursue righteousness and holiness? What can happen to a church that doesn't take seriously the response to Christ to pick up their cross and follow? What can happen to a church that simply says, well, let's redefine sin in our own terms, and maybe we redefine holiness in our own terms, and we redefine everything in our own terms? Well, what do you get after that? I don't think you have a church anymore. You have something else. And we see in this Paul's heart. I will mourn. God will humiliate me. Paul knows where he's going. He's going to come, and he's hoping they're not those who are still stuck in their sin or practicing sin. He's hoping that they're working out their salvation. And he's going to, I mean, this unfolds in chapter 13, where he says in verse 2, if I come again, I will not spare anyone. He's coming to bring discipline, but he's also coming to bring encouragement. He'll say in verse 5, test yourselves. That's not to say if you're out of the faith, but to be encouraged. Are you working against sin? Are you those practicing sin? So we see at the heart of this is edification. This is his expectation, but yet he doesn't, as we read the passage, doesn't seem to be holding out a lot of hope. So what do we learn as a church? What are we to grab from this? Well, my first point is simply this. Edification is the spiritual maturing. Here's the bedrock of all that Paul has written. Here is the reason for chapter 11 and all of his suffering. He says, all this time, right, between you and me, you think it's about me and you and us having this conversation, speaking to the Corinthians, and these false teachers who are saying, well, we knew it, Paul is this, Paul is that. He's saying it is not. All this time you've been thinking we've been defending ourselves. I'm not defending myself. He says, actually, in the sight of God, we have been speaking in Christ and all for your upbuilding, beloved. So all of the church discipline, all of the hard sayings, all of the corrections, what is it for? Edification. You would grow in Christ. That you would present something to the world that is radically different. A Christian is different. The church is different. The world might see a body of believers who look different, come from different backgrounds. When they come together, that's a batch of people that I want to be a part of. They have something I don't. You're to be a fragrance to the world. So here it is, edification, right? The moral and spiritual improvement of the believer. We're growing in Christ. There's a direction of our lives, and Paul has been laboring this way. This is why we want to endure this suffering. This is why I endure all these things, that you guys would know this. I'd build you up. Your faith would be strong. You'd be confident in the Lord. Now, he knows the Corinthians. And remember, when I say he knows them, he personally knows them. He's writing about his third visit. He's the one who planted the church. So when Paul writes these things, there are some faces. I'd imagine that popping right in front of him. Oh, yeah, there's Johnny and Marcus. And I was going to use some real American names. So that'd be funny. But he's thinking about these guys and these families. He knows them. He also knows the heartbreak here that these false teachers have crept in. Man, Johnny was on my side. He was a good guy. Now here it is, right? Johnny's listening to the false teachers. The false teachers are probably telling everyone we knew it, right? He's just trying to defend himself. That's part of what Paul thinks they're thinking, and he's just throwing it out there for us. He states it directly. Here's what's going on. He's like, I'm not doing this. And in actuality, I'm laboring, and all of this has been in the presence of Christ. There's an important point there for us to grab hold of. Your walk with the Lord is always in the context and fellowship of the Lord. There's not a place you go where you're absent from Christ. We say that all the time. He's omnipresent. Where you go, Christ is with you. You are the church everywhere you go. And Paul is saying, all my laboring here, all my suffering, all these moments that I've endured, Christ, it's all been for Christ. Christ is in the presence of this, that you would grow in your holiness, that you would be growing up in the Lord. So here's Paul's motive. I'm motivated the sight of God. I'm motivated to bring up the church. I've been called and commissioned to this. He tells us that in chapter 13, verse 10, with the authority which the Lord gave me to build up and not tear down. He's saying the same words in this. We're here for the upbuilding. This is the drive and the mission. His mission is to build up the church. God has called him to this. See, spiritual maturing is a call on the church. This is our responsibility. This is what Paul is driving at. He has written about the mission back and this serious moment that every believer will have. When he says in chapter 5, verse 10, for we all must appear before the judgment seat of Christ. I was reminded this week as reading something and can't remember the book. I'm one of those bad guys who reads like multiple books at the same time, and was referencing Baxter, Richard Baxter, the Puritan. And the quote was about being ready. And he was stressing upon pastors your responsibility, and I've known this. In my seminary training, your responsibility as a pastor is to make sure that at that moment, when you stand at that moment, you don't hear the words, "I never knew you," but you hear the words, "Well done." And he stressed upon pastors, teach the word, instruct the word, build up the church, right? Edification must go forward, because there is this solemn moment where you will be there. Think for a moment, what are you going to reference? You're going to look to yourself? Are you going to say, "Christ is my Lord and Savior. He has paid it all"? And that seriousness, right? We all must appear. And Paul goes on in chapter 5 of this letter, and he says it's the love of Christ that controls us, right? It compels us. So he is motivated that all that we do, all the suffering, all the enduring, all the hardships, all the moments where you've called me bad names and you thought I was a joke, all of that is for this one moment that you would be building up in Christ, so that that definitive moment, you stand there with confidence. We must be growing in our faith. Again, I can ask that question, what does a church look like that doesn't take this seriously? What do we communicate to a world that if we're not willing to follow Christ ourselves? It doesn't mean, again, I want to stress this, I don't want you to think that you have to be perfect. Perfect happens in glory. Here, you're not perfect, but there must be a pursuit in your life. There must be a direction. There must be spiritual growth. Paul was the spiritual father of this. He planted this church. He has walked with them. He has written a big chunk of the New Testament to this group of believers. 2 letters, 3 visits. He has spent time here. Right? He has endured this. He loves them. But we see that he has a fear, his love for them doesn't change. There's a fear Paul has. So you and I are not, we don't have a calling like Paul. We're not apostles. Some believe that that is true today. That is incorrect. It's a special moment, the planting and the building of the church. But you and I have this call in our lives to build, to grow, to mature for a part of the church. The upbuilding. Paul says in Ephesians 4, 11 and 12, speaking of the leadership's responsibility, and he gave some as apostles and some as prophets and some as evangelists and some as pastors and teachers. Why? For the equipping of the saints, for the work of service, for the building up of the body of Christ. God gives to his church those who will spend time in the word, who will open the word to instruct and teach. Why? So we can be built up. But also, each and every one of us has a responsibility here. We are the body. We are to be building up. We are to be committed. I'm in, not partially in. I'm all in. I'm following after Jesus. See, the committed love the church because they love Christ. We love to serve because Christ served them. They'll go the extra mile because Christ went the mile for them. The Spirit dwells within them. There's solidarity. Those are the committed. The uncommitted reveal themselves as well. They kind of are typically the ones who will go from church to church, or they'll stay on the peripheral. They won't quite get involved in the church because they just don't want to serve. When things get tougher, they look for excuses, they're gone. That's the uncommitted. For those who say, "Christ has redeemed my soul," and we must be maturing. Paul is stressing this. This is why he has written letters under the power of the Holy Spirit. We put up with all the suffering. We too, like Paul, as we walk with one another, are going to go through difficulties. We're going to be frustrated with others in the body, but we're going to continue to grow up and to mature together, because at the end we know the joys. Serving in Christ. The presence of Christ. Paul told the Philippian church, if there is fellowship of the Spirit, then be of the same mind, maintaining the same love, united in spirit, intent on one purpose. Do nothing out of selfish or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, regard one another as more important than yourselves. Do not merely look out for your own personal interests, but also the interests of others. Here's the attitude and disposition of the committed, of those growing in their edification. We have the same spirit as Christ, the mind of Christ. We are united in spirit. We have this purpose, this drive. We are to grow up in Jesus. Paul will mention the word, the preposition for, or on behalf of, or for the sake of, 90 times in his letter. 30 of them will be in this letter alone. For this purpose, on behalf of your care, right? For the sake of you, that you would grow over and over again. He stresses the importance of edification. We can't get around it. If you're here today and thinking, I've prayed that prayer and I'm doing the bare minimum, you know, my walk with the Lord is, it's there. It's sometimes hard to see, but it's there. Well, praise the Lord. Now it's time to grow up. Now it's time to move forward. There's nothing wrong with being on the milk of God if you're a new believer. We all started there, but just as he wrote to the Corinthians is what? It's time to grow up. That was his first letter, continue to move forward. He's saying it again, all of this. Remember, he has pictures. He sees your faces. All of this is for your upbuilding. It is the spiritual maturity. We are to be on this trajectory. He goes from there, and I'll just say this. In verse 20, my second point, it is a personal responsibility. Personal responsibility. Of course, it has to be. We think it's for everyone else, maybe. I mean, that's the challenge. No, it's for you too. He says, for I am afraid that perhaps when I come, I may find you to be not what I wish, and may be found by you to be not what you wish, that perhaps there will be strife, jealousy, anger, tempers, disputes, slanders, gossip, arrogance, disturbances. I mean, here I think we need to get personal. We need to get personal with the Lord. We need to get to this moment of growing out of justifying sins. Paul has already told the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians 3:9, for we are God's fellow workers, you are God's field, God's building. You belong to the Lord. The Hebrew writer says it like this, chapter 3, 12 and 13, take care, brethren, that there not be in any one of you an evil, unbelieving heart that falls away from the living God. But encourage one another day after day, as long as it is still called today, so that none of you will be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. Paul again to the Galatians, Galatians 6:1, brethren, even if anyone is caught in any trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness, each one looking to yourself so that you too will not be tempted. James says it like this. We read these verses yesterday in our men's study, but James, this being the verses which we were studying, James 5, 19 and 20, my brethren, if any among you strays from the truth and one turns him back, let him know that he who turns a sinner from the error of his way will save his soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins. So there's a responsibility in our own walk. There's a responsibility to the church. A responsibility to our brothers and sisters that we collectively would take the seriousness of growing in our edification. This should not be something that we do. It should be who we are. This is who we are. So Paul, like, I'd imagine a father looking at his church or looking at a son who's in his erring ways and hoping the child comes back. He's looking at this church and hoping that they would come back. He says the word perhaps in my translation 2 times. He's begging the question that when I show up, perhaps there might be some maturing there. Or perhaps there might be neglecting. So Paul says, mind my words, personally listen, personally implement. See, Paul is his fear here as he begins to unfold it is he He's fearful this church would become, in essence, a worldly church. It would cease to be a church. If those who are the dominant leaders and the vocal people are the ones who aren't pursuing righteousness, it won't be long before you won't have a congregation anymore. This is why Jesus gives us rules and responsibilities for leadership and dealing with discipline, why he speaks to the seriousness of sin. These things must be dealt with. So here Paul is concerned. He is fearful that there will be, when he gets there, some professing Christians, but really they become a counterfeit or superficial. They profess Christ, but they have a plastic Jesus. You know, it's interesting. We see this in our society. You know, companies go to great lengths to not only develop their product, but get the right cool-looking logo, and they send it around. And some of these things, it doesn't matter what language the product is in. The logo is so good, we know what it is. It doesn't matter where you go. If you see a Coca-Cola can, you know, it doesn't matter what's on it, or what are breathing marks or whatever else. You know it's Coca-Cola. In the same way, these companies spend an exorbitant amount of money fighting other people who are copycats and counterfeits. It's the same way, I believe, in the church. There are many who are counterfeit, who have a counterfeit faith, a counterfeit trust in Jesus. They have what I said earlier. They have a plastic Jesus. And it should not surprise us, because the Bible tells us to beware of what? False gods in Exodus 20, false prophets, Matthew 7, false Christ, Matthew 24, another Jesus, another gospel, false brethren, false teachers, false apostles. And of course, in Revelation 20, Satan who deceives the whole world. There are many, unfortunately, who think they are saved, but they have a counterfeit Christianity. Matthew 7 reveals this to be true. Depart from me, I never knew you. A plastic Jesus cannot save us. Paul is not coming and saying, hey, let's bring the plastic Jesus and get you guys lined out. Paul is coming, and his fear is, I'm coming that you would repent. And if you're outside of Christ, it's time to repent unto salvation. And he'll speak to that. Those who are practicing sin, they have not repented. They need to come to Christ. I believe in our day and age, we understand this. There are those who are superficial. There are those who have told me throughout my years of ministry, you know, I prayed a prayer, I'm good. And, well, okay, well, what's your life showing? Well, I love Jesus. How come you're never at church? Jesus loved the church. The Spirit is in you. You're going to see solidarity. And you can imagine, as Paul's writing these letters, you see probably in the minds of some of these Corinthians, well, let's kick into justification. And so what does he do? Being full of the Holy Spirit, he begins to list the sins that he's hearing about. So he tells us, right? He gives us eight evils here. They're in pairs of two. Verse 2, strife and jealousy. You have rivalries, you have quarreling, you have people who are envy of other people, their position, their pride. They come to church, and what do? They compare themselves. I'm envious of so-and-so. I'm just going to create some strife here. That's not edification. That's undermining any type of unity you'd have in a church. I mean, that leads to segregation. He goes on, angry tempers and disputes. People are just losing their minds. You have party-like spirit there. You have cliques. You know, this is my group. We run with this group. You don't belong in my group. I'm sure that's in the Greek somewhere. But what is that? It's egotism. It's me. It's my standard. You don't meet my standard. It goes on. There's slander and gossip. Well, if you don't meet my standard and I don't want you around, well, I guess I got to go to man, gossip and whisper in some ears to make sure you don't come around at all. Slander and gossip, that's breaking the ninth commandment, bearing false witness. And it says arrogance and disturbances. We can boil this down, right, to pride. These people are full of themselves. And that's the problem. They have redefined what it means to be a follower of Jesus. This church is not pursuing edification. They have not taken personally his words. They are not pursuing it. So Paul's point is forceful. He's coming not for godly sorrow. He's coming for godly repentance. There must be repentance. And they are reluctant to respond. I mean, I think it's Paul, maybe some grace element there where he anticipates some change. Perhaps we won't find each other as we want to find each other, perhaps, but also perhaps I'm going to find you just like I know you're to be, and you're going to find me to be an authoritarian like the Lord has commissioned me to be. See, I think in our Christian walk, sometimes, brothers and sisters, maybe this might be you this morning, where we've come and maybe we've worked through a sin, we've believed on the Lord, and maybe it was years ago, but we kind of feel like, you know, I dealt with that one big sin or those couple of sins back there, I'm pretty good. And we kind of leave it there. We're okay. We kind of lower the bar and lower it a little bit more, and we're okay. I make it to church, I love the Lord, I'll work on that sin occasionally. But nowhere we see that in Paul's writing. But I believe the more we take seriously, the more we uproot some of the sins, the more other sins are exposed. And this is part of growing up in the Lord. This is part of your responsibility as a follower of Jesus Christ and your responsibility to the church. Because as a follower of Christ, you can say, well, you know, I'm good enough. But for Christ's church, that's not acceptable. It's not acceptable personally either. There's a story of a man named Gordon MacDonald. He wrote a book, actually, and part of this book, he kind of revealed this spiritual truth. Him and his wife bought some land in New Hampshire, and they were going to clear it to build a house and put some grass down, and they saw it had a lot of boulders, and as they moved the boulders, they realized there's a lot of little rocks, and they said, no problem. We'll get to these little rocks, and the more they move the little rocks, they begin to see other pebbles and other rocks and other things they didn't see before. And the more they got into it, the more they saw more stones and more rocks. It took time, it took effort, it took labor, but eventually they got the house built and a lawn out front. But it shows us the more we uproot rocks and boulders and sins, there's others that are there. So we shouldn't, the point here is simply we don't come to a place of arrival. That's glory. While we're here, your responsibility to the church, your responsibility for the Lord is to continue to grow. And this is what Paul is fearful. He's not going to find a church that's growing. He's going to find a church that's imbibing the world. And this is where he goes. My last point here, exercise it, right? It's not a one and done. It's a marathon, this life we live following Jesus. I'm afraid, he says it again, I'm afraid that when I come again, my God will humiliate me before you and I may mourn. I'm thinking, he sees the faces, I'll mourn over many of those who have sinned in the past and not repented of impurity, immorality, and sensuality, which they have practiced. You have people who think they're saved and there is no real repentance. Practice doesn't make perfect, but it definitely makes better. They're probably most likely getting better at it. And I know we feel like sometimes, I love this quote from John Flavel, who says, he was a Puritan, it is easier to cry against 1,000 sins of others than to kill one of your own. And we may feel that this morning, but I encourage you, keep pressing on. And I know some of you are walking through it. You're walking through it today, but keep pressing on. Keep going forward. Paul says, God may humiliate me before you. I'll mourn. We see his heart for his people. See, Paul knows what must be done when he comes. There's going to be church discipline. There's going to be an act of publicly moving some of these people outside of the church if there's not repentance. There's going to be some of these hard conversations where he has to confront. He does not want to do this. And even though this action would authenticate his authority, authenticates who Paul's in, he is right. It saddens him. He's a loving pastor. He's a fellow Christian. Here is one who knows something about the grace of God. Here is one who knows the joys and the benefits of believing on the Lord Jesus Christ. Here is one, and at one point in his life, he was attacking the church. He was attacking Christ. Saul, why are you persecuting me? He understands the grace and the mercy, the forgiveness. He sees the faces of the Corinthians, and he realizes there are those who have sins in the past. They're not repenting of them. They're actually practicing them. And what is best for them is church discipline, that they would see the seriousness of their sin and repent. So Paul lists, just so we're all clear on the same page, he doesn't speculate here. He tells us impurity, immorality, and sensuality, right? So you have impurity. This is the unclean. This is the living the way of the world. And immorality has to do with sexual vice or premarital sex or adultery or homosexuality or any other thing attached to that that's impure. And sensuality, which is in essence uncontrolled and undisciplined, unrestrained lust and passion. That sounds like I just defined our world. Again, his point is forceful. Come, repent. Repent. There are those today who attend churches who practice these sins. They think they're clinging to the Christ of Calvary. And again, they say they're clutching a plastic Jesus. Paul told the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians 6:18, flee immorality. Every other sin that a man commits is outside the body, but immorality, the immoral man sins against his own body. Paul links these words together, sensuality and immorality. He says in Galatians 5:19, now the deeds of the flesh are evident, which are immorality, impurity, sensuality. Ephesians 5:3, but immorality and any impurity or greed must not even be named among you, as it is proper among saints. Colossians 3:5, therefore consider the members of the earthly body as dead to immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, and greed, which amounts to idolatry. These sins separate us. They separate us from Christ. And our world desperately wants to suck you into this. And if you're not careful, if you're not exercising your faith, if you're not growing, if your heart isn't growing towards the Lord, well, then it's going to be growing away from Him. See, in our world today, our culture has redefined sexuality to something like it's a personal right. You have a personal right to have sex with just about anything and whatever age it might be. Sorry, but that's the reality of it. We have reduced this to some type of personal choice, like you're buying a car. It doesn't matter. We've changed the language of sin. We've gotten rid of the word completely out of it. And the only time I believe in our culture where this sexual expression is considered wrong is if it's wrong to the person participating in it. If he, she feels this is wrong, then I guess at that point it's wrong. And it's a sad state where Paul comes with these kinds of sins. And you have people who are practicing these kinds of sins. Where over and over we see in Scripture they should be laboring against, fighting against these sins. I love the quote from John MacArthur. I don't have it in my notes. I'll just paraphrase it. But he says, those who are not fighting against sin have no right to claim ever being redeemed from their sins. You might be here this morning, and this might be a real struggle. These are areas where you feel your heart wants to go. Well, if you're practicing these things, I will tell you, if you think you're saved, you have a plastic Jesus. But if you're working against and the Spirit is stirring in your heart and you're pressing against those sins and you're fighting the good fight, then be encouraged. The Spirit is at work. It is those who labor and fight against sin. Those are the ones marked. This is what Paul wants to see. It's not perfection. It is direction of our lives. Edification, exercise it, continue to grow. If you become calloused or cold in your walk with the Lord, your fight against sin will do the same thing. The Puritan, I might as well quote him, he's not in my notes either, but John Owen said, be fighting against sin, is the paraphrase, or it be mortifying sin, or it will be mortifying you. There's no passive ground. There's no time out. There's no coffee breaks. When our mind is in neutral, where does it go? That's a big indicator of our lives. When you have nothing to do and your mind is not engaged in something, where does it go? If it goes to a place it shouldn't start the fight, I like to say bring both barrels of the Word of God to that moment. Fight the good fight. Keep the armor on. And church, I know you. I know many of you closely. And I know your struggles. I know your prayer requests. I know the cry of your heart. And as your pastor, I want to encourage you. Here is the direction. Don't yield in the fight. Don't listen to the lies of the deceiver. Don't come to a moment where you're going to justify some sin and just overlook some sin. Labor against it. Fight against it. And there's moments where your spiritual walk gets a flat tire. Confess that sin. Repent of it. Change the tire. Don't burn the car down. It's because here's the reality. Just as Paul labors for this church, you and I, as we labor in this church, we labor in the presence of our King. He too is with us. He too watches over us. Let our eyes be fixed upon Him as we live our life. Christ, right? Christ, the resurrected Savior. It's a spiritual growing. It's a responsibility. It's meant to be exercised. What can happen? I'll ask the question one last time. What can happen to a church when they don't take edification seriously? But what can happen to a church when brothers and sisters love on one another, who will meet with one another in private, who will be accountable to one another? What kind of church would it be when we see brothers and sisters reach out to one another, strengthen one another, send emails and phone calls and texts saying, hey, I'm praying for you this day. What kind of a church would it be when we see brothers and sisters saying, I know you're struggling, let me pray with you. Let's meet together, let me walk with you, let me help you. What kind of church would that be where you feel that there are those who don't bring judgment but say, hey, there is one who is a judge. Let's work on that. Let's root up these rocks and let's till this ground. And let's see Christ be glorified in the midst of your life. What kind of church would that be when we take seriously these things and we just encourage, where we can say with one another like John Newton, I'm not what I once was, but I'm moving forward. I know I'm not where I want to be. I know there's greater things in front of me, but that's where I'm going. Let me help you. Let the grace of God saturate us. Let us hear the call. Let us receive, right, the command. Let us be those who are marked as those who will go forward. Those who will work through the hard things, those who will work through the difficulties. Let us be those who are marked through suffering, marked through all the issues, marked through the backbiting, those who will put up and stand for truth, because we're building the church, because we do it in the presence of Christ, and because at the end of our lives, we want to be those who know, I wore out my body, I wore out the gospel, and I stand before the Lord. We want to hear the words, well done, well done. Enter into my rest. Friend, that rest is eternal. Here in a moment, we're going to close. It's a new song the Gettys have written. It's simply titled, Hear the Call of the Kingdom. And the first verse says, hear the call of the kingdom, lift your eyes to the king. Let his song rise within you as a fragrant offering of how God, rich in mercy, came in Christ to redeem all those who trust in his unfailing grace. It's a call to pick up the cross. It's a call to be a voice to the world. It's a call to be different. It's a call to be edified. We are not perfect people, but we are people full of grace and mercy who have been redeemed by a perfect Savior. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day and the privilege and honor of bowing our heads before you. And Lord, I know this message stirs our hearts as it did the Corinthians as they read it. We want to be those who are not practicing sin, but struggling against it. We want to be those who are growing more in love with our Savior, that we mourn when we sin against him, and we acknowledge that all our sin is, just as David did, is against you. It grieves you. But Lord, I pray your Spirit to be richly poured out upon us, that you would strengthen us for the fight. Lord, that you would, by your Spirit, continue to reveal hidden sins, things that maybe we haven't seen before, that we would grow in holiness. Let us not, Lord, believe the deceiver when he lies and all the false deceptions that we see throughout Scripture that he has attempted. Let us be those, Lord, who know the real thing, who know Christ. Let us not listen to what the world says. Let us not live ways which the world defines what even sexuality is. But let us be those who come under your word, who look to your word as your word defines what male, female, marriage, all these things as you have designed. So Lord, let us hear the call. Let us pick up that cross. Let us be those marked as different. Lord, bless each soul here this morning that God, we would be encouraged. We're in a war, a spiritual war. And let us be those, Lord, who have the sword of the Spirit in hand and never let it go. Lead us that way. We pray this in the awesome and wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.